Will you stand with me? Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, the senior pastor of this church, the one whom we all desire to follow more than anything. We wouldn't be here tonight, Lord, if it wasn't for him. Wouldn't be here tonight, Lord, if it wasn't for his blood and that cross at Calvary and the resurrection. Wouldn't be here tonight if you didn't see us before the foundation of the world, form us and know us from our mother's womb, before their mother's womb. And God, we give you the praise. We want to do what's right. We don't want to do just what we think or what politicians tell us. My goodness, God, help us to do what's right. It may not feel right. It may not even look right. It might even not even like it. But God, we want to please you more than we want to please man. We want to please you even more than we want to please ourselves. This is not just about how we feel. It's about what you feel. And we want to be pleasing to you. Tonight, Lord, as we get into the word of the Lord, we need your way. We need your will. We need your insight. We need your ability. As a weakened vessel, Lord, I have absolutely no ability to do anything except listen to your voice and speak. And God will give you the praise and give you the glory as you strengthen all of us. Us to hear, us to speak, us to receive, us to do. Follow up with all that you would have. And God will give you the praise and give you the glory and give you the honor. We thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts, our lives. So welcome, Holy Spirit, as our teacher. And God will give you the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. With a great big shout, we say amen. I love literally the title of this message. It's Followers of Christ. And I actually have a little series I've been just doing. It's kind of a fun little thing. You know, when you get old, you do some things. One, you have to make sure your fly is up before you get in front of people. That's for sure. You got to always make sure of that. And when you get old, you have to, make sure that you get a certain amount of sleep at night or you get your nap time in and all that. But I found something I enjoy doing. I love to just write. I've been ministering for 40 years as a theologian. And, I'm going to go be with Jesus someday here, not too long. Some of you got a lot of years ahead of you. I pray that, those years are productive for you. And I don't want just to have 40 years of a relationship with a living Christ and then have it just all forgotten overnight. And so I'm not writing a book, for those of you that want to know. I'm writing to my sons. I'm writing to my son Luke, who you heard this morning. I'm writing to my son Dan. I'm writing to my son Henny Bosman in the Rock Church of Temecula. And I'm writing to my son Eddie Alguera in, if you will, down in Coachella Valley. And just passing on some of the things that I've learned. And tonight, this is kind of a little bit of one little chapter, if that's okay with you. Because I've talked over the years about the character, nature, and attributes of God. Now I want to define them for some of us that are in this place. And if I may, I'd just like to share with you, being a follower of Christ is what we all are. Jesus made this statement. He says, find it in Galatians. Paul writes it, but it's under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So he says, be imitators of Christ. Yeah. And then Paul writes this, follow me. Not just Paul, but he says, as I follow Christ. So the object for all of us is somehow in the life that you have left is to become the greatest follower of Jesus. That's what we did. You know, everybody asked me, how did you pastor this church and how did it get to be where it is and how did it get big and what did you do? And I just followed Jesus. Not smart enough to do anything else, but follow Jesus. It's not about whether I understood the Greek and the Hebrew, even though I did, but I don't preach that. I just simply follow Jesus. I waited until I heard what he said, and then I did it. And that's where we are at with the church. And learning quickly tonight in the Word of God are areas to develop in order to become generous, because God is a generous God. And I want to talk to you about this word generous. I want to say something, and I want you to listen to me, because you want to be blessed in your life, and you know it. You want to raise great kids. You want to have a great marriage. You want to be able to do business and be successful in business. You know, I didn't realize this when we started a men's group not too long ago. We had a business group, and I was just stunned yesterday as we buried our friend Larry Perez, who is one of the leaders of our church here. And the tears just ran down my face, because God had spoken to me about teaching Christian businessmen the principles of the Word of God. And we had about 50 guys, some of you showed up, and I was so disappointed because nobody had a job. I thought God wanted me to teach businessmen, people that were in business. And the people that showed up from our church were people that didn't have a job. And I went home to Deborah and I said, "This stinks. I mean, I missed God or something. I don't know. I'm supposed to be teaching the business principles of the Word of God so they could be financially successful." And so after the first session, our second session or third session, about two or three times, I turned it over to somebody and I was just disappointed. I stand before you as somebody who's repented before God. I missed God, totally missed God. You see, Larry was in that group. And he was one of those guys that came up and said, "I don't even have a job, let alone be a businessman." He was one of the guys that I heard myself say to myself, "What am I doing? San Bernardino doesn't even have business people. What am I doing?" Turned it over after two or three times to somebody else, and you know, that was it, and eventually it went away. Larry had taken some business principles, about three or four of them that I had spoken, and said, "That's from God." And he went out and started a business and became one of the top 50 givers of this church. Of all the, we had 24,000 people in the church at the time, and he was one of the top 50 people by taking four principles, believing they were from God, and doing them. And as I heard that at his funeral yesterday, I think it was Pastor Powell, didn't you say it, Paul? It was Pastor Powell that mentioned that. I just welled up on the inside, realized, my God, I missed God. God wanted me to teach men how to be businessmen, not just businessmen how to do business. He becomes this wealthy man, giving more generous than most people in the church. And I was just stunned by the whole thing and how I had missed the Lord. Because my whole life has been really doing the very best I could to follow God. You know, you don't just follow God. You not only hear his voice, but you have substantial guidelines. You have substantial signs along the way that you know that's where God wants you to be. And I didn't do that. I just went in the flesh and judged everybody and got out of it and went back in here and missed it. What we could have produced. And so the point being is this. This word generosity just jumped out, because if there's anything Larry, who had no job, no education, no experience, and guy, when he passed away yesterday, he was 59 years old, so he had to be in his 50s with no job in a family when he started. And it didn't matter how old he was. It didn't matter when he had done it. When he started to apply the truth of God's word, bang! The whole world changed for him. And he started to become one of the wealthiest people in our church as far as giving. To this day, the family still gives. They had nothing, has something. And this word generosity is so important for us. You will never have a good marriage until you're generous. Can I just say this? It'll shock you, but generosity has very little to do with giving. Did you hear me? Generosity has very little to do with giving. I'll explain that to you as you see it today. But you'll never raise great kids unless you're generous. You will never have a godly business that's prosperous unless you know how to be generous. You will never, ever, ever have a great church if you keep your eyes on the money instead of being generous when God speaks. Because you don't give because you have it. You give because you see it. And when you do, God backs your business, your home, your marriage, your life, your children, and everything. Generosity is a phenomenal word. Many of us don't have anything to do with generosity. We just think bringing a little offering here and there or something like that at the church or giving to somebody at the corner when they're asking for money, that's generous, being generous. And I'm fine with that, but I want you to know something. That's really not generosity. That's just existence. Generosity goes way beyond anything that you could ever imagine. And feel that you're capable of doing. That's generosity. If it was something you had that you could easily give, it's not generosity. If it's something you could figure out, it's not generosity. It's something that goes way beyond who you are, what your thinking is, and what your capability are. When you get past all of that and you put your trust in who Jesus is, then all of a sudden the world starts to open up, and that's what I'm talking about with generosity. And very few people understand that. Even as over the years, one of the things I'm doing is writing to my pastors, but I'm writing to pastors if they should ever read it. Because I can't tell you how many pastors run their churches from a board of directors who is into the finances more than into the spirit. And when finances becomes your direction for choices of making choices, and it's the same with a home, it's the same with you personally, when finances becomes the ability or becomes the choice that you can choose to be generous or not choose to be generous, then you've missed God completely. And I can't tell you how many churches have been destroyed over the years and never become what they could have become because they listened to the accountant in the church service or the board of directors in the church service instead of the Holy Spirit that told them to do something, even though they couldn't do it. Man, we have never in this church been able to do it. We, every person we've ever, ever, ever hired, we did not have the money for it. Every person ever got a raise, we never had the money for it. Every person we've ever gave money to and feed the people, we never had the money for it. We never had money for anything. We had God. And let me tell you something. If the reason you give because you have money instead of God, you have missed generosity. Is anybody listening? And if you didn't get that, you might as well just, I love you. I care enough about you. Just go on home. And you don't have to worry. I'm not taking up an offering tonight afterwards. We've already received that. If I was manipulating you, I would teach on generosity, wouldn't I? And then receive an offering. Because then you'd be more apt to give. I'm not here to manipulate you. I'm here to develop your heart so this all takes place, which brings us to this understanding of generosity a little bit better, if I may. Okay? Areas to develop in order to become generous. Number one, generosity is a heart issue. It's not a wallet issue. It's not a checking account issue. It's not a saving issue. It's not a have it or don't have it issue. It has absolutely nothing to do whether you have it or don't have it. It becomes a heart issue. And so many times we can only go so far because the heart stops us because of our accounting process instead of the spirit processing. Our checkbook tells us what we can do and what we can't do. And so sad, because this is not about the checkbook or the wallet. Why should it have something to say? It's about the heart. We'll see that as we go throughout this time. Moses is building a tabernacle and is instructed by God in Exodus, go there with me, the 35th chapter, to do something, and he makes a statement. And the statement that he makes about generosity, remember, this is their first exposure. These are people that have for a series of years, 400 years, been in bondage. Now they've got Moses. They don't know anything about giving. They've never had anything. They don't have big houses. They don't have cars. They don't have anything. And all of a sudden, Moses is going to make a statement about building and adding to the tabernacle. And he's going to start putting some areas together that are exciting for God. And they need the people to bring in what they have. And I love what it says in Exodus 35, 22. It says they came, both men and women. Isn't that great? Women, we're talking about you. We're talking about men. We're talking about women that are sitting in this room. You can't just blame it on the husband or blame it on the man or blame it on the economy or blame it on the wallet or blame it on the job or blame it on what you have or don't have, because it's, again, it's not about what you have or don't have. It's about your heart. And he says, they came as many as had, who came? A willing heart. A willing heart. And then it goes on in that verse and says they brought everything. They brought all kinds of weird stuff. They didn't just bring gold and silver. Some of them didn't have it. Some of them had necklaces and some of them had nose rings. I've seen some nose rings recently that I pray that you don't drop in the offering. I don't want to touch those suckers. You know what I mean? But these guys, they brought whatever they could bring. And it wasn't just all gold and wealthy stuff. We're talking about people just, whatever they had that was of any value at all, they had a willing heart to do something with it. Can I tell you something? If you're in this place tonight, now listen to me, you may like me or not like me, it doesn't matter. Probably if you don't like me, I don't care, I just love you. I love you enough to tell you the truth. And here's the deal. Listen, I'm not out to be your president. I'm out to be your pastor. You know, and the president isn't out to be the pastor. So stop looking for a pastor as a president. And let me just tell you the way it really is. And it's so important for us to see. This heart issue says everything. And if you and I have a willing heart, that's step number one. Because without a willing heart, nothing is ever going to change in your future. You say, well, Pastor, what if I bring my tithe? What if God speaks to you about going beyond your tithe? What if God doesn't want you just to do what you're supposed to do, but what if you go to a different level of generosity that is what pleases the Lord, that calls for more than what you've been normally doing? And I'm not talking about just money. I'm talking about every area of your life, your service to God, your songs that you sing, the getting out of bed and getting to church and when you don't feel like it. I'm talking about that kind of being generous with everything. Being generous to the neighbor, being generous to someone else. Very important for us to realize that it's a hard issue. Number two is that we're talking about areas of development in order to become generous. Generous is a non-selfish act. It is really not about you. When it becomes you, then it becomes a self-motivated act. And it's really, generosity is really not about you, it is about someone else. And a lot of times we don't understand that generosity is seasoned with this great biblical godly word called mercy. And when that mercy starts to rise on the inside, then all of a sudden I can guarantee you that generosity is going to follow afterwards. When mercy starts to rise, and when you see a value and you care about something and care about them, it's a non, if you will, selfish act, which means that it really is an act that is going to strengthen others. And a lot of times we become generous because we're looking for it to strengthen us. And that's just the wrong attitude. The attitude is that I'm going to do a merciful act way beyond what I think I can do, because what I'm going to do is going to be an encouragement that's going to bring strength to someone else. I'll never forget the time before we started our first church. Debbie and I had moved from Lake Arrowhead, and we lived in Redlands. And then we moved from Redlands back to Lake Arrowhead and then started a church up there. And when we lived in Redlands, I was stunned. There were people actually bringing bags of groceries and dropping them off. Do you remember that, Debbie? At our doorstep. And I had never received anything from anybody before like that. I, you know, be honest with you, had just too much pride to do that. And it was just so offensive to me at first. And then I realized, man, this is an amazing encouragement to us, that someone would believe in us. And they were saying, don't give up yet. Because their gift was a gift that just brought us to a place of realizing that somebody wanted to encourage us to keep on keeping on. And mercy does that. Mercy goes beyond the natural, beyond the norm, goes beyond what you can do, into an area that you can't really do. But what you do is anointed by God because it's generous, and it changes, encourages, and I love this, it strengthens other people. That's why if we had a generous church, it would strengthen all those that are around us, because we gave something that helped build them and encourage them to keep on keeping on. It's not over with yet. And that's what generosity is all about. But that comes, if I may say, with this word mercy attached to it. All of a sudden you feel, by the way, it's probably because of those few bags that we got that today we hand out 7 million pounds a year of groceries. You see how that works? I mean, it's like insane, isn't it? And I love the word of God. We're talking about encouraging. Here's a scripture that I want to take you to, and it's in Ezra. Now you say, where in the heck is Ezra? Ezra is behind 2 Chronicles. So find 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. When you're there, you're going to find 1 and 2 Kings. When you get to Chronicles, go behind 2 Chronicles to Ezra in the first chapter of Ezra. And here we see Ezra. 70 years these have been. This is a Babylonian captivity. Remember the great captivity that children of Israel went through for 400 years with Egypt. After that, because of disobedience, they went into another captivity, which is a smaller captivity of the entire nation, into Babylon. And there in Babylon, they were there for 70 years, and now they're coming out, and they actually come out in two different waves. The first one is Nehemiah, the second one is Ezra. Nehemiah builds the walls, but Ezra builds, if you will, the spirituality of the people. I love Ezra. And he is commissioning something to build a building in Jerusalem, a place to worship God. And he makes this statement in Ezra 1:6. He says, and all of those who were around them, speaking of those that were encouraging them, listen to this, encourage them with articles of silver and gold and goods and livestock with precious things besides all that was willingly offered. They were all willingly offered. But I noticed these words, encouraged them. The word, if you look at this word, encourage them, really means they were around them, brought their goods, yes, but in bringing their goods, it strengthened them. We have a chance to strengthen each other by being generous. We have an opportunity to win the Inland Empire because we want to strengthen the people that are weak. But it isn't going to get done from somebody who doesn't see that generosity is mixed with this mercy that is there for others. And it really is a non-selfish thing that we operate in order to be like God. The third thing that God would have me to share with you about generosity that's so powerful is generosity is an act of love. You know, I always have for 40 years described the word love as personal self-sacrifice. The giving of oneself for the betterment of someone else. I always say it like this, that love is not kissy face and huggy bear. Love is not just roses and flowers. Love is personal self-sacrifice. The giving of oneself for the betterment of someone else. And that's what generosity is. It's the giving of oneself for the betterment of someone else. Nothing could be more like God than the word generosity. If you took generosity out of the word God, you would have not a God that you want to serve. But he is generous in every area, and I myself want to become like him. I find oftentimes that we're caught up with material things. We have friends that have been told by God that their ministry is to be givers, generous givers. And then all of a sudden their ministry starts to prosper because they're giving, and now they're going to spend their money somewhere else like all the other things that they do instead of giving. And then they find themselves trapped, not being able to do what God would have them to do because they put their money somewhere else instead of remaining generous. And sometimes we can get trapped in our own love because we're human. We have feelings and desires and wants. You know, we care about things and we want to satisfy. Can I just say it like this? All of us are the same, including Pastor Jim and Pastor Dan and Pastor Luke. Everybody else, we all have fleshly desires. And when those fleshly desires become more important than generosity, then what we've done is we've voided out the very power of the mercy and generosity of God. And we find ourselves trapped saying that we love, but we're too tied up than to express it. Because love is a giving of oneself for the betterment of someone else. But if I'm so tied up, I can't give, then I don't. And I use that as an excuse. And guys, all of us need to know how important it is that to be generous is an expression of love towards someone that's in need. David writes this word in 1 Chronicles 29. You want to go there with me, you know that's towards, you've already been there, towards the front of your Bible. In 1 Chronicles 29, David says these words in verse number 3. And I love these words. He says, moreover, because I have set my affections on the house of God. Sometimes we just read stuff, we don't really think about what's being said. So I come along and I underline words for you to stop and meditate and think about. He says, moreover, because I have set my affections, he's talking about building the house of God. He says, because I have set my affections. Because I have set my, I don't know if you understood what he just said. He says, moreover, I have set my affections. The word affections means passionate love. But he didn't just say to somebody, you know how some people pray? They pray like this, oh God, give me a passionate love for those things that you want. Like God's going to hit you with a magic wand and you're going to be that way. Notice who set that way. He says, I have set, I have set, I have set, I have set, I have set my affections on the house of my God. In other words, I'm in love with God's people. I'm in love with the broke ones and the hurting ones. I'm in love with the ones that, you know, maybe don't have very many teeth or didn't get the education or maybe didn't have the breaks that you and I have. I'm in love with a city that's down and out and hurting. I'm in love with the persecuted. I'm in love with the poor. God, what can I do to help them out of where they're at so it's not the whole world rotating around me, but my goodness, Lord, the world rotates around you. Because I'm going to go from this place. And when I go, and so will you, you've got to hear these words from God that says, well done, good and faithful servant. But if we're all tied up and our love can't go any more than words instead of indeed, because there's no generosity behind it, and we find ourselves stifled in expressing, but I have set my affections on the house of my God. What he says, I am setting my affections. So what's the house? It's not the building. It's the people in the building. Or are we in love with our city to be generous? Are we in love with the broken? Are we in love with the people that are down and out? Are we in love with those that didn't get the education that you got and I got? Are we in love with those that just can't hold a job together? Maybe it's because of whatever reasons. Maybe they had lousy parents that beat their brains out. Maybe they had a lifestyle. Maybe the uncle came through the room when they were 11 years old and violated them numerous times. Who knows why people are what they are? It doesn't matter. The level field for them is Jesus Christ. And only generosity from God's people with a heart to love the people is going to change the future, not only of our city, but of our state, and of our state, our country, my friends. Amen. And that's what this is all about. This is what God says. Last one for tonight, and we'll finish and close. I love this. Generosity is sacrifice. The craziest thing in the world. Generosity is sacrifice. A lot of times we don't understand that. I'm often reminded, I think, hours after hours of this time that God had with Abraham. Genesis 22, you can read about it yourself. I can't tell you how many hours I've thought about and put myself in Abraham's place as he has this child, Isaac. And he's so in love with this child, he's never been able to. He's 100 years old. Oh, my goodness sakes alive. His wife's womb was dead and he was dead. And God speaks to him at 100 and says, you're going to have this child. And oh, my goodness, at 100 years old, this young man, the only child that he has with Sarah, his beautiful wife, is this young man, Isaac. He is the inheritance. He is the future. This is a great word. He is the promise of the Father to him. And then God speaks to him. I want you to take your son, your only begotten son, and I'll show you where.
And I want you to offer him up as a burnt offering. A burnt offering, my friends, I've told you this before, but I'll remind you again, is not just a normal burnt offering. It's like cremation to the place where there's nothing of value exists. It's burnt beyond any value whatsoever. And God is asking him to offer his son. And he does not know that God that we serve doesn't accept human sacrifice. He doesn't know that. In fact, his background is that he came out of a whole world of human sacrifice for false religions, but he doesn't know that. And God sees wanting to test him to see how far he would go. And he takes that son immediately and he goes where he's supposed to go. And he finds himself and his son says, Dad, I see the wood and I see the flame and I see the rope and I see the knife for the sacrifice. But God, but Dad, his son says, he must be older, like a teenager. And he says, but Dad, I don't see the sacrifice. And he says for the first time these words, Jehovah Jireh, that God will provide. He is the provider. And all of a sudden he raises, ties his son up and he raises his knife. And a voice from heaven says, stop. And he says this, and I don't remember, like 16th or 17th, 15th, 14th verse. And there he says, stop. He says, I now know that you will not harm the lad. He says, I now know that you would not withhold anything from me. And I'm talking about generosity. He would have given God anything God requested of him. Here's my question to all of us. If generosity is sacrifice, and I don't want you to foolishly give your stuff away, but if God speaks to you, would you do it? And after he says, now that I know you will not withhold your son, this is God speaking to him. Three verses later, God says, now I will bless you in your blessings and I will provide for you. In other words, sacrifice, this kind of sacrifice brought the greatest blessings Abraham could ever imagine. And it all came through generosity. Now watch this. Before you clap, let me just take you to the last verse. Luke 21st chapter. Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. In the 21st chapter, in verse number 1, and says this, in verse number 1 through 4, and it says, and he looked up and he saw the rich men putting their gifts into the treasury. Verse 2. And he saw also a certain poor widow putting in 2 mites. Verse 3. And he said, and he's speaking to his disciples, truly I say unto you that this poor widow has put in more than all. Like they're stunned. For all of these, speaking of the rich people, out of their abundance have put into the offering for God. But she, out of her poverty. Now listen to that. But she, here's this woman. They didn't have equal rights in those days that men had. They didn't have equality. They didn't have jobs. They didn't have social security. They didn't have forms of income. But she, in her poverty, watch these words, put in all the livelihood that she had. And when she gave out a sacrifice, it caught the eye and the attention of the Savior. Trust me, my friends, you will meet her in heaven, and she will tell you how the rest of her life was blessed
out of her sandals. I was going to say socks, but Dan Roth has all the socks. Blessed out of her sandals. Because she put in more than, she put in from her heart. She put in non-selfishly as an act to God. She put in her love, and it all equated to sacrifice that brings great blessings. Guys, for us, you know, this week we have a board of directors. Pastor Dan knows, and a lot of the pastors don't know this. And what decisions we make as a church in the future cannot be based on what we have, or there would be no decisions made. Yeah. Let me just be frank with you. Decisions come because God has spoken to do it. Mercy is involved in it. It's an expression of his love, and it will cost you something. And that's generosity. Real generosity isn't the amount. It's an act of the heart. It is a non-selfish act. It is an act of love, and it will cost you dearly. If God spoke to you tonight, would you give him a great big praise? You hear that? But there's great rewards, isn't there? My goodness sakes alive. Great rewards. Well, I'm finished. Thank you for listening to me tonight. Thank you for not being offended over that political statement. In the beginning, I hated to have to do that. I did not want to do that. But we need to take a stand for righteousness, not foolishness. I just want to ask anybody in here that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior, tonight, you have a divine appointment with God. Now listen to me, you might think people brought you here tonight, but God brought you here. Tonight is your night of salvation. Why leave this place tonight the same as when you came in? Why not come and be generous with your life by giving all of it to Jesus? That's called being born again. In order for you to get to heaven, Jesus says you must be born again, John, the third chapter. And he makes it very clear that being born again is not just head knowledge about who Jesus is, because it's not about who you believe in your mind. It's about, because even the devil believes and knows who Jesus is, and he's not going to heaven. Isn't that right? Even the devil knows that. So you could say, I know who Jesus is. I celebrate Christmas and Easter every year. I know about the resurrection. I know about his birth. But that's great. So does the devil know that, and he's not going to heaven. You don't get saved by what you know in your head. You get saved by what your heart has done. This is all about your heart. Yeah, it is. And have you given God all of your heart? And have you given God all of your life? That's that simple. Have you given it to him? Because you are a free will person. You have a choice you can make. Nobody can make the choice for you. Nobody can make that choice. You are the only one that can make the choice to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Your wife can't make it for you. Friends can't make it for you. Nobody. You have to come along and say, I want to give God all of my heart, give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. That's what you say in the depths of your heart, and then you do something about it. And that's what gets you born again. Somebody needs to tell you, because listen, there's a lot of churches out there that are wonderful. I love them. God bless them. But they won't tell you anything about how to get saved. They think if you just go to their church, listen to this stupid preacher, you could just go to heaven. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't. You must be born again. You're going to have to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. Now listen, let me tell you something. Just hear me. Now stop it. Listen to me. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. All or nothing. Somebody needs to tell you that. It's not a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down. That's not what we're talking about. It's all or nothing. If you're going to give God all of your heart, you're going to give God all of your heart. If you're going to give God all of your life, you're going to give God all of your life. You hear me? It's all or nothing, and that's how you get saved. I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, book of Revelation, you heard about it in the Revelation 3rd chapter. Jesus makes a statement. I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Oh my goodness, what a rude, crude statement Jesus said. I'll vomit you from my mouth? I thought Jesus was sweet and kind. No, man, he is up in your face about this. He says, I will vomit you, means you won't make it if you're lukewarm. What's lukewarm? Little in, little out, little up, little down, token prayer, occasional church attendance. You're not against God, but you haven't wholeheartedly given God all of your heart and all of your life. You know, you don't mind if you go to church once in a while, but, you know, not too much. You kind of mix in with everybody. Doesn't work that way. Hot or cold, if you are lukewarm, he'll spit you out of his mouth. Some of you have been lukewarm, even though you think, you can't think your way into heaven, but you think you're a Christian, when in fact, somebody needs to tell you you're not. And tonight is your night of salvation. God brought you here to hear the truth. And you, listen to me, you know it. You know what I just said was true. You can feel it on the inside of you. Even as I speak, you know it. Now don't turn off to that. That's the Holy Spirit nudging you to come and give your heart and life to Jesus Christ. In a moment, I'm going to pray a prayer of salvation. If you want me to include you in that prayer, then in a minute, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand and put it right back down. But I want every head bowed and every eye closed first in this place. Come on, close your eyes, bow your heads. Nobody look, now stop looking at me. Nobody's looking around. This is a moment of privacy I'm giving you. But if you want to be included in that prayer to go to heaven instead of going to hell, because that's where you're going to go if you don't get born again. Come on, let's be honest with each other. Then you need to raise your hand. I'll see it and you can put it right back down. It's your call. You sit there and do nothing, but you will meet up with God someday. Some of you sooner than you think. Some of you sooner than you think. And you better be ready and be washed by the blood of the Lord. Nobody looking around. Everybody's heads bowed, every eye closed. I'm gonna ask you right now, I'll count to three, pop my hands together. If you want me to include you in that prayer, I want you to raise your hand when you hear my hands pop together like that and then put it right back down. Just let me see it. I'll count you and then put it right back down. Are you ready? All across this auditorium, back to the family rooms, wherever you're at. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. Back over here. Is there somebody back over here? Thank you. There's six. Thank you. Put those down in this section. In this section over here, anybody over here? Anybody else? Anybody else? Oh, this far side over here, that's you guys over on this side. Anybody else? There's six wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Thank you. I see that. Go ahead. You can put your hand down. I see that. Seven. God bless you. Anybody else? Hands are still going up. It's not too late, but it will be in a moment. So if you know you need to get your hand up and want to be included in that prayer, then you need to raise your hand right now. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, praise God for six or seven people. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Now, here's what I want you to do. All six or seven of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, water, Bible, friend, get your stuff. Now, listen, I'm going to include you in a prayer, but you're going to have to do something. You're going to have to make some effort. If Jesus can walk a beaten, bloody mess to Calvary for you, while people pulled out his beard, beat him bloody, they spit at him and everything else and humiliated him and brought shame to him, then you can walk a safe aisle
for him. So I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend. If you're sitting next to a friend, nudge them and say, come on, I'll go with you. Let's go. And I want you to get out of your seat, even if you didn't raise your hand, but you should have. But I want every one of you that did raise your hand and anybody that should have raised your hand, I want you to get in the aisle and meet me right here in front. We're all going to stand and give you a hand as you come. You come right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on now, come on. Come on, come on, come on.
Follow Jesus, no turning back.
Come on, you can come. Just come.
No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus.
Come on, you can come too. Come on.
No turning back. No turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back.
Okay, real quick. I was just gonna tell some of you right now. I can feel you out there. You know, you're just saying, ain't no way, I'm not doing that. Trust me, this is the best thing you could ever, ever, ever do. This is what life is all about. Life begins when you walk the aisle. Life begins, and I don't want you to miss it because of your pride. Put your pride aside. I'm gonna have him sing it one more time. Wherever you're at, this side over here, wherever you're at, and I know there's a bunch of you that need to come, get out of your seat, meet me right here in front. I didn't embarrass them, I won't embarrass you. I want you to come right now. You go ahead and sing that song. Get out of your seat. Come on, come on.
I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus.
Well, praise God. You guys came. Yay! Hallelujah. Okay, real quick. See this guy over here? His name is Pastor Joel. He's going to lead you in that prayer I was telling you about. We're going to pray for you. This is it. Takes only a moment. No, I promise you, no weird stuff goes on. You know how you go to church? You say, I wonder what kind of church they are. They're really weird or nutty people, you know? Only when Pastor Dan preaches, you don't even want to come, man. I mean, he's really weird, you know? But no, I'm only kidding. No weird stuff goes on, I promise you. He'll lead you in a prayer, send you right back out to your people. You made the best call of your entire life. Do you know, now wait a minute. Wait a minute. See these people behind you clapping? You may not know this. You're going to spend eternity with them. Oh my goodness. How cool is that? So follow him right over there and he'll let you come right back in. Let's give them a great big praise the Lord. Come on, somebody.